In today's session, we will be talking about the prosthodontic management of temporomandibular disorders. As all of you are aware, that as a professional, we are often encountered with increasing number of cases of temporomandibular disorders. And it is very important for us to understand what are the factors which affect the successful management in patients. So in today's sessions, the learning objectives are: at the end of this session, the participants should be able to understand why we should treat, know different treatment modalities, understand their mechanism of action and role in TMD management, understand the factors affecting the choice of treatment of temporomandibular disorders. So under these headings, we'll be covering the management aspect. To begin with, the definition of temporomandibular disorders or TMDs is, according to GPT-9, the conditions producing abnormal, incomplete or impaired function of temporomandibular joints and or muscles of mastication. So these conditions affect an individual, and that gives an answer to the question why we should treat. Since these conditions affect the form, function and ultimately the quality of life of an individual very adversely, there is a strong reason that we should intervene and provide treatment for such cases. The second reason why we should treat is that research does not support the hypothesis that TMD patients improve spontaneously without treatment. Patients treated with a variety of active modalities achieve clinically and statistically significant levels of improvement with no evidence of symptom relapse after completion. So this is an evidence which tells us about the reason why we should treat the TMDs. The third reason why we should treat is that the temporomandibular disorders are interrelated. For example, a masticatory muscle disorder is very much likely to cause a disc derangement disorder if it is left untreated, and this can also cause an inflammatory disorder, and ultimately it can lead to mandibular hypomobility disorder. So all these temporomandibular disorders, types of temporomandibular disorders, are interrelated, and one thing can lead to other if it is left untreated. And therefore the aim of treatment is not only to provide a curative treatment to a symptomatic relief, but also to prevent the disease progression. So three reasons why we should intervene and give treatment is that, first, that we have seen it affects the form, function and quality of life. The second, research has shown that whenever the treatment is provided, the patients are benefited. And third is that to prevent the disease progression, it is imperative that we provide active treatment. So moving on to the second point, which is why managing a TMD is a unique challenge. It is unique because of its pathophysiology. Now in this figure, which is adapted from Jeffrey Okeson, the individual has no symptoms and he is asymptomatic with normal functioning masticatory system. And in that, we can have these etiological factors: occlusal factors, trauma, emotional stress, deep pain input and parafunction. So these are the etiological factors of the temporomandibular disorders. Now, these factors can cause a temporomandibular disorder only if the individual adapting capacity is surpassed. Individual can no longer adapt to these particular insults which are happening from either intrinsically or extrinsically. Now in such cases, we can see the manifestation of TMDs. But individual adaptability is different according to different person. It is dependent upon the genetics, it is dependent upon the biological factors, hormonal factors and other factors which are yet to be investigated. And therefore, even if these etiological factors are present in probably an asymptomatic individual and a symptomatic individual, you cannot pinpoint that because of this, this has happened. For example, a person may have occlusal factors, occlusal interferences, but can be asymptomatic. But a similar kind of occlusal factor can lead to symptoms in other individual. So what decides which one, which individual gives symptoms and which doesn't is only the individual adapting capacity. And in such case, each individual becomes a unique challenge because each individual will respond to treatment in a different manner, and therefore it is unique to manage the temporomandibular disorders, and the approach is completely customized to each patient. Now let us see various treatment modalities. They are broadly classified into definitive and supportive. Definitive are occlusal therapy, surgical therapy, and specific therapy for etiological factors, when you can identify them or when you can attribute the causation of TMD to a particular etiological factor. Occlusal therapy can be reversible, can be irreversible. Reversible occlusal therapy is in the form of occlusal splints. Irreversible occlusal therapy is in the form of occlusal equilibration, placement of restoration, and orthodontic treatment. The surgical treatment is of various types, meniscectomy, condylectomy, and many more. The second type of treatment is supportive therapy. It is divided into physical therapy, physical self-regulation, and pharmacotherapy. We will see this in brief in coming slides. Our main focus of today's session will be on the prosthodontic management, which comes under occlusal therapy, that is reversible and irreversible. So we'll stress upon these particular aspects in detail. Now the next question which comes to mind is, which therapy is best? What we should choose in which patients? Now for this question, there is lack of adequate scientific evidence. The results of a review suggest that the best available evidence for or against the use of any therapy for TMD patients is based on evidence below the level of randomized controlled trials. Now, as you can notice that there are very, very less amount of randomized controlled trial, and therefore it is very, very difficult to come out with a rule of a thumb for management of TMD. But nonetheless, patients are there and we have to manage them. So let us learn how to do it effectively. The second important factor is that in temporomandibular disorders, the specific diagnostic categories are not clear. There is a classification of TMD which is proposed by many authors and has been suggested and adapted, and since these diagnostic categories are not clear, whatever studies have happened, we cannot have a generalized conclusion to them. The another reason is that some etiological factors are difficult to control or eliminate, like emotional stress. It is highly unlikely that a patient will have, you know, zero emotional stress, or you know, you can have an evidence that he has a zero amount of emotional stress. So these etiological factors are difficult to control or eliminate. Pain intensity varies greatly over time, and therefore patient's perceived need for treatment is variable. Sometimes the patient may say that I am having pain and I want the treatment to be done, but that pain intensity might go off after some time. Maybe during the day also there are diurnal variations, and therefore patient's perceived need for treatment is very, very variable. So these are the few aspects which don't let us draw conclusions on the question that which therapy is the best. You know, like we have discussed, that there is inadequate scientific evidence, and there are other factors that I have explained which make us in a fix that you know, what we should conclude then in the end. So these are the certain factors which affect the clear-cut conclusions to be drawn in this TMD case. But still, we will go ahead and see the management aspect. So first and foremost, let us get to the root cause, that is the etiology. Now, as you have seen, that etiological factors are occlusal factors, trauma, emotional stress, deep pain input, and parafunction. So up till now, these are the etiological factors, and scientific evidences will again give us clue about certain other etiological factors. But as of now, we have these five etiological factors which are causing the TMDs. So now our therapy is directed towards the etiological factors. So one by one we will see all the etiological factors. First comes the occlusal factors, and definitive therapy for occlusal factors we will discuss first. Before we begin, let us revise what is optimum functional occlusion. What is optimum functional occlusion? Only then we will see what is abnormal. So let us see what is normal. So in optimum functional occlusion, these are the features that there is a centric relation which is in harmony with the centric occlusion. There is canine guidance, there is protrusive disocclusion, there is axial loading of the teeth, and there is light contact on the anterior. So these are the six requirements for optimal functional occlusion. Now let us see what happens when there is a interference, or whenever there is a TMD. What happens exactly? So in this first image, you can see that when the teeth are apart, the elevator muscles maintain the condyles in their musculoskeletally stable position. What is this musculoskeletally stable position? It is a superior anterior position resting against the posterior slopes of the articulating eminence. In this situation, there is a joint stability. You can see there is a joint stability. Now, as soon as we close the mouth, okay, as soon as the mouth is closed, a single tooth contact does not allow the entire dental arch to gain full intercuspation. So this is an interference. At this point, there is an occlusal instability. Okay, so this is occlusal instability, but joint is still stable. Since the condyles and the teeth do not fit in a stable relationship at the same time, this is orthopedic instability. Right? So this is orthopedic instability, where the joints are stable but the occlusion is not stable, and this gives rise to orthopedic instability. Now what happens further? In order to gain the occlusal stability, now teeth have to come in contact. Then what happens? What does the body do? In order to get the occlusal stability necessary for the functional activities, the mandible is shifted forward and intercuspal position is achieved. Now this is occlusal stable. Occlusion is stable because the mandible has shifted. And now the teeth can come into contact. There is a proper intercuspation. But this has happened at an expense of the joint instability. This joint, which was earlier stable, is now unstable. And therefore, this condyle disc assembly is under the strain, and it can result into intracapsular disorder and other subsequent deterioration. So this is the pathophysiology of how occlusal factors are proposed to play a role in causation of the temporomandibular disorders. Let us come to the predisposing factor. We have seen what is orthopedic instability. Now what are the predisposing factor which lead to orthopedic instability? These are investigated by Pallinger et al., and they are as skeletal anterior open bite, position slides of greater than 2 millimeters. Now what is a positional slide is that we have seen in the earlier slide that the mandible moves forward in order to get the tight intercuspation. So this slide, if it is more than 2 millimeters, it is a great risk. Overjet of greater than 4 millimeter, 5 or more missing and unreplaced posterior teeth. Now these are predisposing factor, and please mind well that these are predisposing factor. They need not indicate presence of TMD. Some patients might show, some patients may adapt to it and will not show the signs and symptoms of temporomandibular disorder. So ultimately, what do we conclude? The degree of orthopedic instability more than 2 millimeters, and the amount of loading, that is the bruxism and unilateral chewing, all this will give you signs and symptoms. Now remember that there is orthopedic instability which has to be there, and there is additional amount of loading in the form of parafunction, bruxism, unilateral chewing. Now all these are placing extra load on the temporomandibular joint, which is already unstable. Okay, so important factor here to understand is that there is an orthopedic instability, and in that instability we are loading the joint even more further in the form of parafunction, bruxism, unilateral chewing. So obviously something which is weak we are making weaker and weaker again, and that will give you the manifestation of TMDs. And this is the reason why patients with similar occlusal conditions may not develop similar disorders. The reason is that some patients may adapt because they don't have parafunctional activities, they don't have unilateral chewing, they don't have bruxism, and they adapt even if there is a joint instability. But the moment such weak joint is loaded, then there will be manifestation, and therefore this varies patient to patient, and therefore there will be differences in manifestation. So I hope this is clear, the point. Moving forward to reversible occlusal and irreversible occlusal therapy. Reversible occlusal therapy provides the orthopedic stability, it reduces the parafunction, allows healing of the retrodiscal tissue in the intracapsular and some inflammatory disorder, and helps in diagnosing the etiology. Irreversible occlusal therapy, which involves the selective grinding by either the conventional method or DTR and immediate complete anterior guidance development. We will see this in detail. It's a restorative treatment. It's a treatment which is irreversible, and this particular irreversible occlusal therapy should be given after the reversible occlusal therapy has shown good results. Only then the patient is a candidate for irreversible occlusal therapy. Right. So moving forward to occlusal splints. Okay, occlusal splints, which are the main treatment modality in reversible occlusal therapy. So what is a splint? Essentially, it is a device which holds the anatomical structures in a particular way which promotes healing in desired position and gives a symptomatic relief. Like it is done for any, you know, a fracture in the joint or fracture in the extremities. So what do? We put them together in a desired position and we immobilize it. Immobilization will give you desired healing, healing in a desired position. So what is occlusal splint? Almost the similar one, which is a removable one. It is made up of hard acrylic which fits over the occlusal and incisor surface of the teeth in one arch, creates precise occlusal contact with the teeth in the opposing arch for diagnosis and therapy. So it is like any other splint which you are used for treating any other disorder, musculoskeletal disorder in the extremities. Similarly, occlusal splint will hold the teeth in a desired position till our joint is properly healed. So let us see what is the mechanism of action of occlusal splint. The mechanism is divided into various parts and everything is very important. So I will go in detail about this particular aspect because this is the foundation for understanding the or choosing the correct occlusal splint. Now, what does a splint do? First, it alters the occlusal conditions. Okay, so whenever there is, you know, non-uniform contact, there are interferences, and there is no canine guidance, and so what the splint will do is that it provides uniform contact with canine guidance. So this is an optimum condition, and this is provided so that the tissues in the temporomandibular joint may get a chance to heal in this optimum condition. The second mechanism is that altered condylar position is structurally and functionally compatible position. Okay, altered condylar position to a more musculoskeletally stable and structurally compatible and functional position. So as there was occlusal interference, we have seen that whenever there is occlusal interference, there is occlusal instability, and to achieve stable occlusion, the joint sacrifices its own stability and goes into orthopedic instability. Now, when we remove this occlusal or orthopedic instability in the joint by using occlusal splint, that is we make the centric relation and centric occlusion coincide. Okay, centric relation is the optimum position for the joint, centric occlusion is for the teeth. When both of them are in harmony, that is the most desirable position, and splint does exactly that. It provides you a uniform contact, it is in harmony with the centric relation, and this is musculoskeletally stable position, and this is the main mechanism of action. Now there are certain other things which the splint does, like it changes the peripheral sensory input, and that leads to reduced centrally mediated bruxism. The appliance does not cure bruxism, it only inhibits the bruxing tendency while it is being worn. Okay, so this is also an alternative explanation to how they are effective in treatment of TMDs, that it changes the peripheral sensory input, which reduces the centrally mediated bruxism. The other mechanism of action of the occlusal splint is that it increases the vertical dimension. An increase in vertical dimension can temporarily decrease the muscle activity and the symptoms. So this is another explanation. The other factor is that there is something called as cognitive awareness. This particular appliance or occlusal splint acts as a constant reminder to alter the activities that might affect the disorder. So cognitively the patient is aware all the time, and that might cause that might explain the success of occlusal splints. There is something called as natural musculoskeletal recovery associated with rest. This can also be the reason why we can see the remission of the symptoms in a particular patient. Now, placebo effect, again with any other treatment, like any other treatment, there can be a placebo effect also. There is something called as regression to mean, and very important in temporomandibular disorder, that we often see that the intensity of the pain varies on a daily basis. In the morning, afternoon, evening, the pain scores are different. Some days will be quite marked with pain, while other days are more tolerable. And you can see that naturally itself, as a natural course of the disorder in that particular individual, even if you give the splint or any other treatment or not, the patient may show or may report that the signs or symptoms, the severity has reduced. And this can be attributed to the fact that there is something called as regression to mean, because of variations, diurnal variations, and differences in the intensity over the days. So these are the possible explanations by which the splint acts. Okay, so to revise these, that first and foremost, there is alteration in the occlusal conditions, there is alteration in the condylar position, and these are in harmony with each other. Then there is a changed peripheral sensory input. There may be increased VD, which is contributing to the success. There is cognitive awareness. And apart from these six reasons, there are three other reasons which are non-attributable to the occlusal splint, but still contribute towards the regression of the disorder. And those are three. First, natural musculoskeletal recovery, placebo effect, and regression to mean. So these are the 9 possible mechanism of action explanations by which the occlusal splint acts. So in one research, Alexandra et al. Found that plasma levels of calcitonin gene related peptide were increased in the TMD patients which are treated with occlusal splints. Now this particular CGRP is a potent neuropeptide. It plays an essential role in stretching and relaxing the muscle, neurogenic vasodilatation, and maintaining the functional integrity of the peripheral tissue. Increased level of CGRP reflects reduced activity of muscles responsible for maximum mouth opening. So it is another possible explanation of action of a splint, that it increases the CGRP levels, reducing the muscle activity. Now when to use the splint? Now there are two types of splint. which are broad types of splint, stabilization and anterior repositioning splint. Now, stabilization splint is indicated for muscle pain disorders like local muscle soreness or centrally mediated myalgia. Also, retrodiscitis secondary to trauma. These are the indication for secondary stabilization splint. The anterior repositioning splint, on the other hand, is indicated in the intracapsular disorders, disc displacements, disc dislocation with reduction. So these are the indications of different types of splints. Now, there is very commonly asked question whether hard splint is effective or soft splint is effective. So both forms of occlusal splint, soft or hard, have shown improvement in the temporomandibular joint symptoms in patients with MPDS or internal disc derangements. However, the soft occlusal splints exhibited superior results after 4 months of use. Now, this is according to one research. I'm sure there will be some researchers who have contradictory findings. But when you look for such evidence to such controversial questions, you should always examine the methodology of that particular study. If they have taken a proper sample size, if they have randomized it, if they have removed the all confounding factors, done a proper statistical analysis, and after doing all this, right now the evidence says that there is no difference between the hard and soft splint. The second question is about the duration of use, which is which varies according to the type of splint. So stabilization splint is as per the course of the disorder, and anterior repositioning splint should be used for as less time as possible and preferably at night time. A word of caution is for partial coverage or unilateral splints. So these splints can cause supra eruption of teeth and joint overload. So we have to use them very, very carefully, and if at all possible, we should avoid their use, partial coverage or unilateral splints. Now, what is the efficacy? What does the evidence or scientific literature say about the efficacy? Overall, the splint reduced the electrical activity of the analyzed muscles and made it more equilibrated on right and left side. This is according to one research. This particular research also says that the pain frequency and pain levels in the TMD patient is reduced because of the splints. The splint therapy increased the mouth opening ability in patients with initial disorders where there was less than 45 millimeters of maximum mouth opening. Therefore, we can see that there is ample amount of objective evidence regarding the efficacy of the occlusal splints. Now let us come to the fabrication technique. So how to fabricate a stabilization splint? A stabilization splint, when it is in place, the condyles are in their most musculoskeletally stable position. We have seen that in the earlier slide. At the time, the teeth are contacting evenly and simultaneously. So CR is equal to CO. There is canine disocclusion of posterior teeth during eccentric movement. And the treatment goal of the stabilization appliance is to eliminate any orthopedic instability between occlusal position and joint position, thus removing this instability as a causative factor in the temporomandibular disorder. It is indicated for occluso-muscle disorders and certain internal disc derangements. Now, there are some important factors which are to be taken into consideration while fabrication. First is to locate a musculoskeletally stable position is very, very important. So musculoskeletally stable position is the centric relation position, should be recorded by bilateral manipulation, bimanual manipulation with load testing after deprogramming. So these very, very important terminologies. First is load testing, deprogramming and bimanual manipulation. Now, after recording this, it has to be fabricated and equilibrated for maximum efficiency, and we have to take repeated follow-ups. So let us come to the detailed stepwise procedure. First, what do we do is take a 2 to 2.5 millimeters thick clear resin sheet and adapt it on a cast with pressure adapter. small amount of self-polymerizing acrylic resin is added on the anterior portion of the appliance as a stop for the lower incisor. The area of this stop is approximately 4 to 6 millimeters. This stop thickness is separating the anterior teeth by 3 to 5 millimeters and posterior teeth by 1 to 3 millimeters. Mandibular posterior teeth should not contact on any portion of the appliance. Now, we have to take into account that this anterior stop has to be fabricated very, very carefully. Okay, so if it is distally inclined, if it is inclined distally, it will deflect the mandible posteriorly. If it is mesially inclined, it will deflect the mandible anteriorly. So we don't want both of this. What we want is that a key to successful fabrication of appliance is finding the most suitable position for eliminating patient's symptom. The anterior stop should be perpendicular to the long axis of the lower incisors and it should be as thin as possible. So it should not be distally inclined, mesially inclined, it should be perpendicular to the mandibular anteriors. After we fabricate this particular stop, what we do is we manipulate the mandible with both our hands in C shape, like you can see in the picture, and take it into the most musculoskeletally stable position in centric relation. And once we take there and we are sure that this is the position, we have to load test it. Okay, load test is that we take the mandible and examine if by giving pressure whether it is giving any symptoms or whether it is showing any signs of pain. And if it is negative for load testing, then we can go ahead and surely say that this is the musculoskeletally stable position. So this was about recording the musculoskeletally stable position. Once we have recorded the position, then we have to remove the appliance and we have to insert the autopolymerizing acrylic resin onto it. Again, it is placed on the patient's mouth and the patient is asked to bite on it and move the mandible to the in lateral excursions and make sure that it is canine guided and no other teeth are touching in the lateral excursions. And this is, and there is, you know, stable stop in the centric both sides and there is canine guidance. Okay. So lines in front and dots at the behind posterior area. So this is how it should look. Final stabilization splint. Okay, canine guidance, stable centric contacts and no interferences. Now coming to the fabrication technique of anterior repositioning splint. How do we fabricate? Let us understand what happens when there is an anteriorly displaced disc. You can see in this picture, all the pictures and the photographs are taken from Okeson's book on temporomandibular disorders. Now this is anteriorly displaced disc with condyles articulating on the retrodiscal tissues producing pain. Okay, now you can see here this disc is anteriorly displaced, white colored disc. Okay, when it is anteriorly displaced, the retrodiscal tissues, which are red in color, the condyle goes and articulates with the retrodiscal tissues, giving you pain. Now, the condyles moved off these tissues to allow the healing. What do we do by giving a anterior repositioning splint is we are giving the tissues to fibrose, okay, to adapt so that there is no pain when the condyle articulates on them. So after the appliance is discontinued, condyle articulates on the adapted fibrotic tissue. So this is the mechanism of action. Now here in this splint, you can see that there is centric relation position. Earlier in the stabilization splint, you must have noticed that there was only centric relation position. But now in this splint, there is anterior therapeutic position that eliminates the clicking and pain. So this is anteriorly repositioned mandible, and this distance depends on patients to, it varies patients to patient, and it depends on the, you know, position which will allow the disappearance of the symptoms or eliminate the pain and clicking. So that position we have to consider as final position. Now when the indication, what are the indication for anterior repositioning splint? Any displacement and dislocation with reduction, patients with joint sound, intermittent or tonic locking of the joint, inflammatory disorder, especially when a slight anterior positioning of the condyle is more comfortable for the patient. Now there are certain rules which are very very important when we are giving anterior repositioning splint. The rule number one is that if the clicking and pain symptoms have been eliminated with only the increase in vertical dimension and improved joint stability is provided by the stop, a stabilization splint should be fabricated as previously described. Rule number two, if the joint pain and clicking have not been eliminated, the patient is instructed to protrude the mandible slightly and to open and close the mouth in this position. Like this. The joint is re-evaluated for symptoms and the anterior position that stops the clicking is marked with red marking paper and this is considered the final position. Now this position should be the shortest anterior distance from musculoskeletally stable position that eliminates the symptoms. So as less protrusion as possible we have to take. Rule number four is that during the day the appliance should not be worn so that normal function of the condyle will promote the development of fibrotic connective tissue in the retrodiscal tissues. Rule five is if the patient reports pain during the day, the appliance may be worn for the short periods of time throughout the day to reduce the pain, but otherwise it is not indicated for daytime use. And as soon as the symptoms are resolved, pain is gone, the use of appliance is limited to nighttime use only. Now this mandibular anterior repositioning appliance may be more acceptable from a functional and aesthetic standpoint. Okay, when we talk about whether we should give it in the maxillary arch or a mandibular arch. So to answer that question, mandibular anterior repositioning appliance may be more acceptable from a functional and aesthetic standpoint. But if only we are using it for the daytime, the aesthetics matter. So maximum if it is a nighttime use, maxillary appliance is a best choice. Since patient in the maxillary appliance, the patient, it is likely that the patient may retrude the mandible during sleep. And this particular ramp on the maxillary appliance easily prevents that, restricts the movement, the retrusive movement of the mandible during sleep, and which is not there in if you take a mandibular appliance. So maxillary appliance is always preferable, and if you look at the evidence, both maxillary and mandibular appliances reduce the symptoms equally. Now what are the key elements is basically when we talk about the occlusal splints, the key elements are that a follow-up fabrication, a very meticulous fabrication, and case selection, very very important. These three factors will decide the success of the occlusal splint therapy. Whether we take a routine follow-up, whether we change the occlusal, you know, we have to equilibrate the occlusal contacts on the occlusal splint, whether we have fabricated it correctly, whether we have recorded the centric relation properly, whether we have selected a case properly, whether it is a case of anterior repositioning splint or a stabilization. So all these factors will decide how much it will be effective in the long run. Coming to the second aspect of the occlusal therapy is the irreversible occlusal therapy, which is also known as selective grinding. Now this selective grinding can be done by conventional method or by a more sophisticated procedure that we'll see in the subsequent slides. To begin with, let us first understand what are the indications for the irreversible occlusal therapy. As the name suggests, it is irreversible in nature, as in contrast with the reversible splint therapy, which is, you know, the effects are not, effects can be reversed. When you discontinue the occlusal splint, you can regain whatever was there in original place. But if irreversible occlusal therapy is done, then the changes are permanent. So what are the indications? Very, very important to understand. The indications are whenever the occlusal splint has eliminated the TMD symptoms, occlusal contact or jaw position is the primary etiology which is suspected by the dentist, and there is an anterior slide of less than 2 mm. So these are the indications. Now what are the procedures involved in the irreversible occlusal therapy? The first and foremost is the mounting and mock selective grinding in the centric relation. Occlusal treatment must never begin without visualizing the final result as well as each step that will make it possible. So we have to do a diagnostic mounting in centric relation, take a CR record, mount the mandibular cast, and we also have to see how much tooth structure needs to be removed in order to get the occlusal stability. Amount of loss of tooth structure. As it is irreversible in nature, we cannot sacrifice lot of tooth structure and we cannot go blindly into reducing the occlusal interferences. So when we do the mounting and do the mock selective grinding, there is a rule of thirds that has to be followed. So the inner incline of the centric cusps is divided into thirds. Okay, you can see that this is the centric cusp, maxillary palatal cusp, and the inner incline is divided into 3 parts. Now whenever condyle is there in the desired position at that particular point, the initial contact of the lower centric cusp is on the third closest to the central fossa. Okay, you can see a dark blue line. If the contact of the cusp is here on the dark blue line, selective grinding can be successfully established. If it is on the other third, okay, if it is again shifting here mediolaterally, you can see that the you can see the second stripe which is there, then we have to probably place a crown and only then it can be corrected. Occlusal grinding will lead to lot of loss of tooth structure. And if it is on the last third, okay, you can see here, if it is on the last third, then orthodontic movement or orthognathic surgery is the option. So this is the rule of thirds, and this will give us an idea about the what we have to follow and what are the patients, which are the patients in which the selective grinding will be effective. Now this is as to how to decide whether to go for it or not, and when we decide we have to go for it, then how to do it. So eliminating interferences, there are 2 types of interferences, centric and eccentric. Centric interferences to the arc of closure, as you can see in the picture, centric interferences to the arc of closure can be eliminated by MUDL. This rule, MUDL, mesial of upper and distal of lower, the line of closure, the interferences which are there in the line of closure can also be eliminated. You can see here in this particular image that this particular cusp is interfering for proper closure. So likewise we have to equilibrate. For eccentric interferences, as per Schuler's time honored rule, we have to do the selective grinding by Bull's law, that is buccal of upper and lingual of lower. For balancing interferences, lingual of upper and buccal of lower. For walking interferences, distal of upper and mesial of lower for posterior protrusive interferences. Okay, so this method of adjustment leaves centric contacts undisturbed. So this is the rule for eliminating the lateral interferences. Now coming to the irreversible occlusal therapy by using recent methods such as DTR and ICAGD using T-scan, JVA and EMG. So what is DTR and what is ICAGD? This technique was first described as complete anterior guidance development by Kirsten and Ferrell in 1990. Now disocclusion time is defined as the time required for posterior teeth to separate from each other during an excursion. Okay. Now what is the rationale for this particular technique? As explained by Williamson and Langquist, they showed that the premolar and molar contact in lateral excursive movements activates more muscles than do the anterior teeth. So when we move the teeth, posterior teeth sideways, this activates the masticatory muscles more than the contact between the anterior teeth. So what will happen? That whenever there is disocclusion of the posterior teeth, what will happen? It will lead to reduced compression in the periodontal ligament. It will lead to reduced lactic acid buildup in the muscle. It will improve the muscle oxygenation and it will reduce the ischemia, and all these factors will lead to muscle relaxation. Okay, so what is the rationale of posterior disocclusion or immediate anterior guidance development and posterior disocclusion? Immediate. So that these are the factors. Now to understand it even more further, what is the difference between a occlusal equilibration by selective grinding and immediate complete anterior guidance development? What is the basic difference? So the differences are as follows. The goal of occlusal equilibration is guided CR closure. Okay, as we have seen that we have to first record centric, and from that we have to start on removing the interferences. But in immediate anterior guidance development, the goal is not centric. We have to get immediate posterior disocclusion. The goal is immediate posterior disocclusion, and for routine occlusal equilibration, the goal is guided CR closures. Now, initial adjustment step is centric relation, and in ICHED, it is excursive movements. Now, this considers CR and CO as coincident. Now here CO anterior to CR and pre-treatment MIT, and it is unguided. Changes in the quantity of molar contact is increased in this occlusal equilibration and it is decreased in this particular technique. The importance of lateral interferences. In this technique, lateral interferences are considered as potentially damaging to the teeth, and here it is considered that they cause the compression of the periodontal ligament and therefore they are damaging. Now here we don't do deprogramming. In the occlusal equilibration we do deprogramming, but here in immediate complete anterior guidance development there is no need for deprogramming before the procedure. So this was about the differences in the conventional occlusal equilibration and ICHED. Now measurements for disocclusion time during excursive movements in force movie is as follows. Class 1 and class 2 occlusion until only canine and incisor guidance contacts, and class 2 occlusion until furthest anterior working premolar. So this is about the disocclusion time during the excursive movement. Now how do we record this particular occlusal interferences? In this technique we use a T-scan scanner which is there, which is 100 microns thick. This is the sheet, and when varying levels of applied force load the sensor, differing amounts of electricity is given off within this sensor grid. This electronic output, called as digital output or DO, is then displayed for playback and analysis within the four desktop analysis windows. Okay, so let us see what exactly the T-scan analyzes. Now this T-scan sensor analyzes initial occlusal contact, the order in or sequence in which all the occlusal contact occur, amount of relative occlusal load during each occlusal contact. So these are the three things which are evaluated by the T-scan 3, okay, the latest version of T-scan, which is nothing but computerized occlusal analysis. Now this computerized occlusal analysis will give you an idea as to where there is occlusal contact initially, where are the other occlusal contacts happening as time progresses, and what is the exact amount of force which is being applied at that particular occlusal contact at that particular time. So all this is given in real time, and computer guided occlusal adjustments can be then employed to alter a poorly contacting tooth sequence into a contact sequence where multiple equal intensity contacts are occurring simultaneously throughout the arches bilaterally. Okay, so all this is done with computerized analysis. Now here you can see in this picture force versus time graphs, changing occlusal force percentages across the time in both left arch and the right arch. Okay, so the color and the height of each bar indicates the intensity of force, as red indicates the maximum intensity. Okay, so this is the amount of contact, and here you can see the area which is contacting first and then the second. So this is a two-dimensional dental arch. Now there is something called as force trajectory. Okay, you can see the force trajectory. This is in red. It shows the history of the path, the center of the force from the beginning of the force movie recording to the current displayed frame. The establishment of true and measurable bilateral simultaneous occlusal contact is thus achieved. Now here in this picture you can see that the leftward movement of the trajectory is due to the contact of the tooth 26 at 0.469 seconds. The force trajectory shows that there is a right-sided premature contact. Significant occlusal correction is required on the right side. Now here we can see that the force trajectory after the correction shows a more uniform contact. Okay, so all this can be seen real time. Now according to the literature, values of the center of the occlusal force distance and asymmetry index of the occlusal force in TMD patients with pain in the TMJ were significantly higher in the control group. So we can see that it has been effective in reducing the pain in the TMJ in this particular study. In other study, the occlusion time and disocclusion time in patients with TM joint disorders are significantly extended than the normal subjects. The balancing interferences, group function and centric slide more than 2 mm found to have a strong association with TMD. So here as you can see that this is a computerized analysis and we can get values as less as fractions of second. Now in combination with the T-scan, we also have something called as electromyography or EMG, just to coincide or correlate the findings of the occlusal scan. We can also have EMG recordings so that at that particular point when there is a interference, whether the muscles are firing at a high level, we can correlate and then we can reduce accordingly. So as you can see here in this picture, the muscle activity here before equilibration and after equilibration, as well as in this figure. Okay, so there is definitely a link between the equilibration using T-scan and its relation to the EMG. Excursive muscle hyperactivity can be a source of lactic acid accumulation and muscular ischemia and chronic myalgic temporomandibular joint dysfunction symptoms. So when properly performed such that the post-treatment disocclusion time is 0.4 seconds, less than 0.4 seconds, the immediate complete anterior guidance development in ameloplasty predictably reduces the excursive muscle activity levels in bilateral anterior temporalis and masseter muscles. So this is according to the research done by Robert Kirsten, and it clearly tells that less than 0.4 second of disocclusion time will give you less muscle activity and will lead to improvement in the symptoms. So but we have to keep in mind that this is for the occluso muscle disorders. In the classification of temporomandibular disorders, we have occluso muscle disorders, internal derangements, inflammatory disorders and mandibular hypomobility disorders. So out of these, occluso muscle disorders are being shown to benefit from this particular DTR and immediate complete anterior guidance development. Another question which comes in our mind is that, is occlusal splint alone sufficient? So the answer is that there is something called as a multidisciplinary model for treatment. An emphasis has to be placed on this particular multidisciplinary model. Like in any other musculoskeletal disorder, where there is also physical and behavioral management of the patient's own problem. Majority of the TM joint disorder patients achieve good relief of symptoms with non-invasive reversible therapy. So to answer the question, is occlusal splint alone sufficient? It is probably not. There is another aspect to this particular thing, and we will discuss this in the subsequent slides. So coming to the definitive therapy for emotional stress. Now we have finished the definitive therapy for occlusal factors, the first etiological factor, that is occlusal factor. Now coming to the second factor, which is emotional stress. How to handle this factor? Now this is out of management of, you know, if you think about prostodontic management, this is out of our domain. But however, the patients we need to treat and take into account these factors, we should be aware of this, that how to handle the emotional stress. Now stress as per se leads to increased sympathetic activity and upregulation of the autonomic nervous system, which leads to increased tonicity of the muscle, increased parafunctional activity, and reduced adaptability. So this is how the stress affects the individual's capacity to adapt. So how to manage the stress effectively is by using physical self-regulation. And to each and every patient, we should be telling this particular therapy, which is PSR, given by Carlson and Burton in 1995. So in this physical self-regulation, the patient has to made aware about these factors: pain and fatigue, posture, breathing patterns, improvement of sleep, and nutrition. So this entire PSR program is presented in a framework which focuses on the understanding of pain as a physiologic disturbance, which is best managed by the patient himself, you know, taking into account, introspecting as to what is going wrong, whether the posture is correct, breathing pattern is correct, sleep is sufficient, nutrition is good, whether there is a lot of fatigability. So all these factors has to be assessed by the patient for himself or herself, and active measures for correction have to be taken along with our prostodontic therapy, that whatever we have done, PSR has to go hand in hand. So this success of PSR depends upon patient's belief, his determination, and dentist and patient's active participation. So if you ask that what will happen if, you know, will my TMD go off if I do yoga? What will happen if I sleep more? Will my TMD go off? So the answer to these questions are probably not satisfactory, because we have to believe in this, that there is something called as physical self-regulation, which is effective and may take a lot of time to show results, but it does work. According to the literature, it does work in many patients. Along with the definitive therapy, this therapy also work, because it takes care of the emotional stress, which is the very very important etiological factor. Now apart from PSR, there is also active relaxation therapy in the form of biofeedback, where you can see in this picture the patient is encouraged to assume the relaxed position in a comfortable quiet setting. The EMG sensors are applied to the masseter muscle. A finger sensor may also be used to monitor the temperature and or galvanic skin response. The patient is instructed to relax the muscle as much as possible. The computer monitor provides immediate feedback regarding the success in reducing the muscle activity. And after such several training sessions, the patient becomes aware that, you know, how to relax effectively, and the patient is encouraged to accomplish this without the biofeedback unit. So effective relaxation of muscle reduces the muscle symptoms. So this is biofeedback for reducing the emotional stress. Now one very important factor here is that we should have a very good positive doctor-patient relationship in management of TMD. It is all the more important that there is a role of a dentist is for education, motivation, confidence building, and reassurance of the patient. That some of the patients are in quite distress when there is a lot of kicking, clicking, popping of the joint, and pain and reduced movement, and the patient is in, you know, constant discomfort, limited range of movement and everything. So in such situations, it is very important to have a positive doctor patient relationship. It goes a long way in success of the treatment. So this finishes the emotional stress as a factor. Now coming to deep pain inputs as an etiological factor, and what is the definitive therapy for deep pain inputs? By deep pain input, what we mean is that there is an acute source of deep pain input which can lead to protective co-contraction of the muscle. Okay, for example, there is a third molar here which is erupting, and there is a pericoronitis, and that is leading to pain, and that pain is leading to co-contraction of the muscles, and therefore the patient cannot open the mouth. Or there is an aphthous ulcer over here, and which is painful, and it is causing limited mouth opening. So these are the deep pain inputs which we have to look for and treat for the management of TMD. Now these can also occur from other areas. For example, there is a cervical spine injury. There are trigger points here, okay, and there is referred pain in the face, you know, there is cervical spondylosis, and you know, where there is a source of pain which is located somewhere else in the area of the body, and therefore we have to locate them and we have to treat them. Now coming to another very very important etiological factor, that is parafunction, and what is the definitive therapy for parafunction. Let us first understand that what is parafunction and function. Why it is important to understand. Now you can notice here that parafunctional activity places 57,000 pounds of forces per day or more on the tooth contact, okay, as opposed to 17,000 in the functional activity. The direction is vertical, the forces are vertically directed in functional activities, and forces are horizontal in a parafunctional activity. The third point which comes is the mandibular position. So in functional activity, the mandibular position is in centric occlusion, which is relatively stable, and in parafunctional activity, the mandibular position is eccentric. As the parafunctional movement is in eccentric direction, therefore it is a relatively unstable position. Now the type of muscle contraction in functional activity is isotonic, which is physiologic, and in parafunctional activity it is isometric. That is also one factor. Now influence of protective reflexes is present in functional activity, which is reduced in the parafunctional activity, and pathologic effects of functional activity are unlikely, and pathological effect of parafunctional activity are highly likely. There are several types of parafunctional activities, but clenching and bruxism seem to be the most significant. Now there is diurnal parafunctional activity, and which is also there because of the emotional stress and acute changes in the occlusion. So this diurnal activity or diurnal parafunction or diurnal bruxism, which we call, when it is there, then how we can treat it? By patient's education and cognitive awareness strategies, out of which occlusal splint is also a method to provide cognitive awareness. But when it is a nocturnal bruxism or a nocturnal parafunctional activity, it is more centrally mediated, and in that centrally mediated activity, occlusal splint is a temporary relief. Okay, so we have to think about other strategies such as sedative and antidepressant medications, of course with the consultation of the physician. So these are the two different basic types of the parafunctional activity, diurnal and nocturnal. The mechanisms are different, and therefore the treatment is also different. The factor of trauma as a etiological factor, and how to treat definitive therapy. Now here we start going into the domain of surgery, the oral surgery, and therefore I will not go into detail about this. I will just mention what are different types of treatment modalities without going into the detail. So trauma, how can the trauma occur? Trauma can be of two types: macro trauma, which is extrinsic, and micro trauma, which is intrinsic. Macro trauma can be a direct and indirect. Okay, so direct blow to the patient's chin, direct blow to any other part of the face which lead to the propagation of the injury to the condylar head and structures of the TMJ. This is macro trauma. Now we can prevent it with using mouth guard or helmet or other protective gears. But micro trauma, which is intrinsic, it is by repeatedly closing into something which is orthopedic instability. Okay, which creates the orthopedic in the instability. There is repeated closure and repeated loading of the joint, and that leads to micro trauma. So we can treat this by using the splint. Now, what are the definitive surgical therapies? Now, surgical treatment can be arthrocentesis and lavage, arthroscopy, arthrotomy with disc repair, arthrotomy with discectomy, arthrotomy with discectomy and autologous graft disc replacement, arthrotomy with discectomy and autologous flap reconstructions, arthrotomy and discectomy and alloplastic disc replacement and condylotomy. So all these and many more modalities are there which are out of the scope of the prosthodontic management, and we will leave this particular aspect here. But we will ask a very pertinent question: when to go for surgeries? So when to go for surgeries, there are advantages and disadvantages of surgical treatment. As you can see that surgical treatment is irreversible, and therefore the decision as to go for surgery or not depends upon the pain levels of the patients. When we think that the etiology cannot be altered, we cannot help the patient by altering the etiology, and when the quality of the life of the patient is enormously affected. So these are the three aspects. We have to weigh the pros and cons, and then we have to decide whether to go for surgery or not. So in the, this finishes our definitive therapy. Now in the supportive therapy, we have pharmacological therapy, analgesics, anti-inflammatory, anticonvulsants, antidepressants, muscle relaxants, anxiolytic agents, injectables and topical. So all these drugs are available, again out of the scope of today's session, so we will not go into the detail of this. Another type of supportive therapy is physical therapy, extremely important and extremely effective. So it is of various types: thermotherapy, moist heat, it is applied to the symptomatic muscle, and moist heat pad or a warm moist towel can be used. Coolant therapy, an ice pack is applied to the painful area for 2 to 4 minutes until the tissue feels numb, and then the tissue is slowly allowed to warm again. This can be repeated as needed. Eyes should not be left on the face for longer than 5 to 7 minutes, otherwise there will be tissue injury. Ultrasound therapy is there. It increases the temperature of the interface of the tissues and thus provides a deep heat. Iontophoresis is there, where the medication is placed in a pad and then a low electrical current is passed through the pad, driving the medication into the tissue. Local anesthetics and anti-inflammatory drugs are commonly used with iontophoresis. Transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation, TENS, is another effective method, where a portable TENS unit is placed over the painful areas, and this is accomplished by mild electrical stimulation of cutaneous sensory nerves. Now there are other manual techniques also which help in this disorders: soft tissue mobilization, joint mobilization, muscle conditioning, passive muscle stretching, assisted muscle stretching, resistance exercises, postural training and acupuncture. So these are all the techniques which are available. You can see here soft tissue mobilization to relieve the spasm, joint mobilization so that the adhesions are released. So all these methods are available. Very important is resistance exercises which utilize the concept of reflex relaxation to provide the greater mandibular opening. Now in addition with these exercises, there is something that we can do to manage the trigger points, like assisted muscle stretching, spray and stretch technique, trigger point injection of the local anesthetic agent. These two techniques are important for managing the trigger points. There is nowadays a lot of interest is being generated in Botox for the treatment of TMD. So you can see here that this is the facial diagram of transcutaneous needle placement for injection of botulinum toxin to the temporalis and masseter muscles. Now, this injection of botulinum toxin into the muscle shows some promising results. It is not the first line of treatment since it is not a definitive therapy. Also, botulinum toxin is relatively expensive and may not be a suitable treatment option for all patients. Now, which are the patients for this particular treatment? The patients of chronic myofascial TMD, oromandibular dystonia and refractory headaches. So these are the patients. So here you can see intraoral EMG guided injection of botulinum toxin to the lateral pterygoid muscle. So this has shown some promising results. However, we have to do a proper case selection and follow up of the patient. A very important question here is that how do we sequence the treatment in particular in this temporomandibular disorder? How do we sequence the treatment? So the treatment sequencing depends. Since there is, as we have seen in the initial slides, that there is a disease progression. Muscle disorder can give rise to the disc derangement, can give rise to the inflammatory disorder, can lead to mandibular hypotonia. So all this is interrelated. So if it is very possible that in a patient there may be an internal disc derangement also present, and there may be a muscle disorder which also may be present. So which to treat first? So in this, we can say safely that the primary diagnosis is for the muscle disorder, and the treatment also should begin with conservative treatment strategies, right? So whenever we are in a fix that there is some component of disc derangement disorder and there is also muscle disorder at the same time, so the primary diagnosis is first to treat the muscle disorder and see whether the symptoms are subsiding, and then slowly increase the nature of your treatment and make it into a more irreversible treatment. So for example, to start with, give a stabilization splint if you are suspecting a disc derangement disorder. It is safe to start with the stabilization splint, and then if at all it is not getting reduced, then we can move on to the anterior repositioning splint. So start from conservative is the message. Now the final take home for this is that treatment should be dependent upon the type of disorder. It should be dependent upon the etiology of the disorder, because the etiology, as we have seen, five factors and how we should manage them, etiology will decide the nature of the treatment very core sense. So etiological factors and type of disorders are very important, and proper and thorough diagnosis is extremely important. Now treatment response is also important. Many times we see a immediate response to the treatment, and many times there is no response to the treatment whatsoever we do, the patient does not show any relief. So in that, we have to evaluate patient's adaptability and take into account, we have seen the pathophysiology, and without getting demotivated, we have to keep on trying and evaluate ourselves whether we are going wrong somewhere or whether patient is not eliciting proper history, and all this has to take it into account. And of course, the treatment sequencing is important. We don't have to directly jump to the irreversible mode of treatment. We have to give reversible treatment a chance. We have to try the PSR, we have to try the supportive therapy, and only when the reversible occlusal therapy is showing some effect, success, only then irreversible occlusal therapy can be thought about. So the treatment of temporomandibular disorder is custom made. It has to be conservative and reversible as far as possible. And I will like to acknowledge Jeffrey Ocasen and his book on management of temporomandibular disorders and occlusion. And he is the Bible. The book is the Bible, and he is the God of TMDs. And I express my sincere gratitude towards the book and the author, and they have helped me in making this presentation. So I thank you for your attention, and proud to be a prosthodontist. If any queries, please feel free to contact me. Thank you very much.